PS5 class. My name is Caitlin Lustig, and today I want to talk to you about social regulation in Bitcoin. So this is the first part of a two-part video. In the first part, I want to talk about what is Bitcoin and a little bit about how Bitcoin impacts the environment. In part two, I'll talk about why we care how Bitcoin is regulated, how it's regulated, and talk a little bit about maybe some ways that we can make Bitcoin better. So first off, what is Bitcoin? Bitcoin is an online currency that has received a lot of attention in recent years, but it's still not really that well understood by a lot of people. So I just want to give you a brief overview of how it works. So first of all, to understand Bitcoin, we have to talk about why it was made. Bitcoin was made as a reaction against traditional currencies like the US dollar. So when you use a traditional currency online, you have to go through a payment intermediary. And the payment intermediary will check that you're spending money that you actually have. So without a payment intermediary, it might be possible for me to spend some money at Amazon and then very quickly spend that money at eBay. And my bank account might not reflect those changes. And I might be able to get away with it. So a payment intermediary makes sure that I'm not what they call double spending the money that I have. But in order to do that, they have to get private information about you, and they charge transaction fees. So Bitcoin is a reaction against this, and with Bitcoin, all the transactions are pseudo-anonymous. So pseudo-anonymous means that you have some sort of identifying username or string of characters that is associated with you. In this case, with Bitcoin, there are addresses that you can use that people can send money to, or you can send money from, that are associated with you, but there's no identifying information. It's sort of like how you might use a Reddit account, and you probably wouldn't use your real name as your username, so people can see all these posts were made by you, but they don't know who you actually are. So that's what I mean by pseudo-anonymous. So Bitcoin is pseudo-anonymous, and all the transactions that you make are part of this public ledger called the blockchain. And so it's all public, but nobody knows exactly who made those transactions. And participation in this system is incentivized by mining, which I'll talk a little bit more about in a few minutes. So the person who created, or people who created Bitcoin, her name's Satoshi Nakamoto, and this was created in 2009 by this person. And we don't know a lot about them. It's a pseudonym, and it could be one person, it could be multiple people. Newsweek thought that they had found Satoshi, and it seems unlikely that they actually had. So we still don't know who it is. There are different theories. Satoshi disappeared from Bitcoin around mid-2010 and only reappeared online recently to tell Newsweek that they had gotten the wrong person. So Satoshi is sort of a mysterious figure. But Satoshi did leave forum comments, so we have some idea of some of the beliefs of Satoshi. So Satoshi said, "Bitcoin is very attractive to the libertarian viewpoint if we can explain it properly. I'm better with code than with words, though." So libertarians often believe in smaller government, the free market, and the freedom of choice. Now, the word libertarian means different things in different cultures, particularly means something a little bit different in Europe than in America, but I'm using more of the American definition in this presentation. When Satoshi said that, it suggests that there might be political reasons for creating Bitcoin. A lot of people recently have been disappointed with the economic situation in America and across the world. And part of the dissatisfaction has to do with how money can just be printed. And they feel that that devalues the currency that they use. So Bitcoin is different than that because it has no centralized authority. There's no person deciding how many Bitcoins are produced. And there's no, some Bitcoin people feel that there are no politics involved with Bitcoin. It's just pure technology. There's no human influence. In part two of this lecture, I'm going to talk about that a little bit more and why that's maybe not 100% correct. But this is just to give you an overview right now of how Bitcoin works. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about is the blockchain. So people run Bitcoin software on their computers, just in the background. They're not, you know, actively using this software. And what it does is it verifies transactions that people make. So if I send off half a Bitcoin to someone as payment, the software will check to make sure that I am sending Bitcoins that I actually have. When it checks this against this public ledger. If I've done that correctly and I'm spending what I actually have, then it will get bundled in with other transactions that have been made around the same time, and it will get placed into this public ledger called the blockchain as a new block in the blockchain. So as you can see in the picture, there are different branches on the blockchain. There are various reasons for why the blockchain can split, but if it does, what happens is that the people running the software can basically vote on which branch they think is correct by adding more blocks to that branch. The branch with the most amount of blocks will become the official blockchain. And this voting mechanism will become important later when we talk a little bit more about this in part two of this video. So just keep that in mind. All right, so mining. In order to incentivize people to run this software, every time they process a transaction, there's a somewhat random chance that they may complete this calculation. And if they complete a certain calculation that is also run at the same time as checking this transaction, then they will receive some new Bitcoins. And that's how Bitcoins are created. They're not minted like the US dollar. This is how people create new Bitcoins. And so it also incentivizes people to use the software, right? So they might get paid for actually running the software, basically. And so as time has gone on, more and more people are trying to mine Bitcoins, and they're using better and better hardware to do it. In fact, there's specialized hardware now for people to mine Bitcoins with. And so now people mine in groups because that makes it a little bit easier to get some Bitcoins out of it. And so generally what happens when you mine in a group is that based on the number of calculations you've run, you'll receive that percentage of Bitcoins when the whole group is rewarded with some Bitcoins. So I have some pictures of mining hardware, and as you can see, some of it's very well organized, some of it is very messy, some of it uses equipment that's quite large, and some of it uses a lot of small equipment. So there's a whole big variation on how people mine. And one question that often comes up is mining bad for the environment? Because when you mine, you're using electricity, right? And when you use electricity, there's CO2 produced. Well, so this is a topic of debate. And arguably, mining is actually better for the environment than traditional currencies, because when you use traditional currencies, that can involve gold mining, if you're sticking with the gold standard. It can involve gold recycling. If you're using paper currency, you have to mint it, you have to transport it, you have the whole banking system. So those all produce a lot of CO2. So Bitcoin may arguably be better for the environment. So in part two, we're going to learn about how Bitcoin is regulated. And by regulated, I mean how people in the community govern it. Because, as I said, there's no central authority that manages Bitcoin. So I want to talk a little bit about the social norms around Bitcoin. All right, I will see you for part two.